Good morning, church. Chino's here. Welcome to C3. So excited to have you with us this morning. We're just about to jump into worship. Going to read a scripture real quick, and then we jump into worship. As you know, as we jump into the worship this morning, just to explain a little and put into context the scripture I'm going to read, you know, I think one of the benefits of, you know, engaging in worship is that we get to experience the renewal of God. So this morning, as you know, we engage in worship, just put aside what's happened this week and just dive in and really let God just change and transform those areas of you that he wants to do a work in. The scripture I'm going to read is in the book of Ezekiel. It says here, Ezekiel chapter 36, 26 to 27, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I'll remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. How amazing. You know, as we just dive into worship, just open yourself to that beautiful exchange with God where we give him our week, we give him those things that have weighed us down, and he gives us in turn his life. So Father God, we thank you for this morning. We're excited, Lord, that what you're doing in our lives. Lord, what a great privilege for us to have that beautiful exchange of us giving you our weeks and you in turn giving us your presence, your kingdom, your life. So I pray every home that's tuned in, every ear that's tuned in, every person humming to the tune of worship, Lord, will just experience a transformation by your spirit this morning. Just have your way in our hearts, have your way in our homes, in Jesus' name. Take it away, worship team.
Oh, I'm sorry. More than anything that you can do.
Amazing worship. Thank you so much, worship team, for always bringing us into the throne room of God. Again, welcome to C3. If you're joining in for the first time, welcome. And down in the description below, we just love for you. If you'd like to get in touch with us, we definitely would love for you to get in touch with us because we want to get in touch with you. Click on the link and it'll take you to a page where you can just fill out a little bit about yourself so that we can reach out to you and, you know, get you connected with what's going on in the life of the church. So much exciting stuff happening. You know, everyone in this time needs a body to connect with. So we'd love for you to connect with us here at C3 Manhattan. All right. So at this time, I'd like to go ahead and prepare to receive the offering, give you a few minutes to, you know, get out your phone, whatever you need to do. And this week, in speaking about the offering message, I was inspired, and I'd like to share what my inspiration was with you. Bear with me because I am going somewhere with this. This week, I was inspired by the life of the goats. You know, the animal goats? Yes, I was inspired by that. And you're like, Chinos, where are you going with this? But, you know, growing up for me, goats were just animals. You know, I grew up in Africa. So, you know, when you're talking about goats, it's about a goat you can cook, you know, goat pepper soup. And they're really great. And in recent times, goats have been getting good publicity. I don't know who's doing the PR for goats, but it's going really well for them. Goats are now brought into the city to eat pasture. You don't have to use lawnmowers. There's goat soup. There's now goat milk, goat soap, but that's not what I'm talking about this morning. If you think about goats, goats eat a lot of grass, and after they go to a place and they just stand for a while or whatever they do, but the grass they eat is in them. It doesn't digest immediately. It's regurgitated. And, you know, there are a couple of stomachs in these goats. I don't know how many, but they're not like humans that just have one stomach. And they chew on this grass, and then the grass is then in a different place, then moved back, and they can be in a different pasture, and then they regurgitate the grass. So where am I going with this? That's one thing goats do, but I think it's very important to realize, because the goats get the nutrients out of that grass as much as they eat it. The second set of goats I want to talk about, this is one I just came across recently. It's a trend. If you're into sports, it's trending in sports where there are different groups talking about the goats of a sport or the goats of an industry. Where are you going with this, Chinos? I think it's really interesting because these goats in this industry are people that have impacted that industry. And they're not just goats, it's the greatest of all time. I didn't know about this. I had to research it because I follow soccer, and one of my favorite players, Messi, was on the front of a magazine and he was carrying this goat. And I was like, what is this all about? I mean, growing up, a goat for me, what you called someone a goat, there goes the neighborhood. That's like an insult. But here these guys are fighting over being called the goat. But one thing about these goats, or the greatest of all times, was when you do research on who they were or how they became the greatest, they just don't have this great trajectory of being awesome all the time. You have them breaking into an industry, experiencing a low point, experiencing a comeback, and then they excelled to become great, and then they became the greatest of all time in that industry. But when you interview them, and I think even Pastor Stephen has mentioned this before, most of these great athletes have one thing in common. When you ask them, you were out of the limelight for a while, what happened? They talk about how they went back to the basics, the foundation, when they wanted to continue on. Like you've reached the top of your industry. What inspires you to keep going on? They came back to the foundation. So back to my animal goats, consistency, chewing, regurgitating that, you know, grass, humans, us, the church, regurgitating the word of God, and consistency. So consistency and that sense of foundation, going back to the foundations. How does that tie into giving? When you think about giving, one of the most important things that we need to know is there's a lot happening in our society today. People are experiencing different things. The systems they've had their assurance in has kind of like, some people have lost jobs. Some people have been through illnesses and different things. But one of the things that I believe will empower people in this time is going back to the consistent things you know you are meant to do as a believer, going back to the Word of God, or just simply being consistent with things like giving. So what word, if you were to go back to the Word of God, would I encourage you to remember? Here in this scripture that I'm about to read for the offering, I'd really like you to see the conversation between God and this prophet. It says in the book of Ezekiel, chapter 37, 2-4, it says that he, being God, he led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord." And it goes on to talk about what the prophecy was, but that's not the point. The point was there was a word given to him. And there are a lot of things happening in society today right now. I was at home and I got a text message from a colleague, and he was like, "The diner across the street, his clothes." And then he typed also, "Permanently." And I typed back to him, "No." And then he was also the bagel restaurant across the street, "Closed." And then we're like, is it even worth going back to the office? My point is that there are things drying up around us, or we might hear about it. And if you're someone who's not experienced hardship, I think that's a testimony, because we're not here to say everything is doom and gloom. But for those that might experience loss, you know, it's not something to be ashamed of. Everybody's experiencing it. But my encouragement to you is that we can learn from the goat. What do we do in these times? We go back to the things we know. We regurgitate that word. We hold on to that word, and we're consistent with it. So my encouragement to you as you prepare to give is to remember that's what it's all about. You know, that we're people that have been called to be consistent with the word of God. What can God do? I believe God is going to, you know, give you words to speak over those things that might be drying up. It could be finances. It could be relationships. It could be health in this time. Just think about the social, racial tensions. You know, there are people overwhelmed with that. But I believe instead of us just throwing in the towel, what can God do? Can these things live again? So I believe your finances will live again as we pray over this offering. You know, just get that faith and stir yourself up that better days are ahead. Amen. So, Father God, we thank you, Lord, that we can learn from nature, that, Lord, even the animals, your word says the birds, the grass, you provide and they grow, Lord. We can learn that animals, they eat grass and they regurgitate it. Lord, I pray that we would be people who just hold on to your word and meditate on it. We're not naive of the things happening, but I believe you're providing for us as we speak your word over dry situations. So, Lord, as a church, we gather this morning in agreement, speaking over our finances, speaking over our relationships, that you are blessing this church. That, Lord, there are a lot of people in this time that have been blessed from this church, and we pray, Lord, that you continue to provide for us, because there are a lot of more people that still need to be blessed by this church. So we thank you for this time. We just praise you. We thank you for those things you've blessed us with, and we pray that we continue to be good stewards of them. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So a few announcements. Here we go again. Today, yesterday, I'm hearing you say that in your living rooms, at 5 p.m., we will be gathering at Hudson River Park. Grab a blanket, grab some dinner, and come out. If you walk all the way at the end of West 12th Street, we'll be there. So come on out, and we'd love to see your smiling faces. Definitely bring your mask. You know, it's going to be a social distancing church-wide picnic, so all are welcome. All right. And now at this time, please join me as we welcome the one and only, our senior pastor, Pastor Stephen.
Hey, church, how are we? I hope you're doing well. Well, it's in virtual time. It is Saturday night, but in real time, it's Sunday morning, and I'm in two places at two different times, but virtually in the same place at the same time. So, come on, think about that for a minute. Okay, Schrodinger's cat, where is he? So, basically, all I'm saying is, while I'm preaching at you as a team, we're also here at Northmore and we're joining you for the service, but we're also working on the space, getting equipment installed. We've still got some equipment to come. Looking forward to being also live, as opposed to just live with you on Sunday mornings. Anyway, we're praying for you. Don't forget, Church Picnic is on tonight, 5 o'clock by the Hudson River. Come and hang out. Don't forget, you have to wear a mask, mandatory. Bring a mask, and we're going to, you know, look after each other's health, and we're going to hang out and have a great time. But come and hang out. We love you. So why don't you turn with me to the Word of God, John chapter 3, verse 1. There was a man named Nicodemus, a Jewish religious leader who was a Pharisee. After dark one evening, he came to speak with Jesus, and he said, Rabbi, he says, we all know that you are from God, and he has sent you to teach us. Your miraculous signs are evidence that God is with you. And Jesus replied, I'll tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. And then Nicodemus says this. He says, what do you mean? Exclaimed Nicodemus. How can an old man go back into his mother's womb and be born again? And Jesus replied, I assure you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and the Spirit. Humans can reproduce only human life, but the Holy Spirit gives birth to spiritual life. So don't be surprised when I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it wants, just as you can hear the wind, but can't tell where it comes from or where it is going, so you can't explain how people are born of the Spirit. Then Nicodemus says, at this point, I'm agreeing with Nicodemus. He says, how are these things possible? And Jesus replied, you are a respected Jewish teacher, and yet you don't understand these things. This has got to be the biggest bunch of miscommunication on the planet going on here, people. Doesn't it? And I thought this would help you and I a little bit. I feel like we're living in a world right now that's speaking at least two different languages, if not more. And sometimes I feel like I'm trapped in between two contradictory points of view, in between the screen door and life, and I'm just being jammed a little bit here. So let me just go back a little bit and think about what's going on here. Nicodemus, he's not a Pharisee that's trying to trap Jesus. He has a legitimate question, but underneath the question is a legitimate desire. He wants something. So the first thing that I want us to think about is that he's looking for something. What is it that Nicodemus is looking for? Because whatever it is, Jesus seems to be completely ignoring what it is that he's asking and really answer some other question. Which really, when you think about it, isn't who Jesus is. He really is trying to answer Nicodemus's question, but that would tell you something. It would tell you that the question that Nicodemus is asking isn't really the question that's in his heart. He's having trouble locating what his real question is. Jesus gives him an answer, and then there's this ongoing misunderstanding about what it means to be reborn, and this collection of ideas that comes along with it that I want us to look at. So what is it that Nicodemus is after? What's his real question here? And I think the question that's on a lot of our minds right now is the same one that was on Nicodemus's mind. And his real question is this: can I change? Can people change? I'm a keeper of the law, and I'm writing laws that translate the word of God into living action, and yet I'm still not sure if I can change. I'm still not sure if people can change. So I want to just say two things from the outset. I think the gospel is pretty clear on most levels that any change that we're seeking starts with personal change. It's not restricted to personal change, but if we want to see something change around us, that change has to start in us. And the second thing I want to just put into our minds today is that I feel like we're in danger of Christianity being watered down to mere spirituality, to a sense in which we lose the power that Jesus is trying to talk about here, where we lose what he means when he says, you must be born again. And in order to maybe facilitate change, maybe in order to get away from conflict, maybe in order to just have conflict, I don't know. I feel like we are in danger of watering down our faith in Christ to mere Christian spirituality. I'm a spiritual person. That's all that matters. The beliefs that I have can change as long as there's a spiritual undercurrent to those changes. And there's many things that go along with this that we're going to look at as we go along. But I wanted to start with those two points. Point one was what? Nicodemus's real question is, can I change? That's his question. And I think I want to give us some faith today that Jesus is trying to say, you can change. You just have to remember how it is that change happens and where it happens. And then secondly, we need to be careful to keep the personality of Jesus central to our walk with God, and not just a mere blur of I'm a spiritual, caring, loving person, and that's enough. It's not enough. Because if it was enough, Nicodemus wouldn't have the question. Because Nicodemus had a loving God, a loving Bible, not the New Testament part, but he had the Word of God, and he spent his whole life looking at ways to integrate that into a very spiritual life, a very dedicated life, with lots of rules, with lots of morality and ways of living. And yet he was still going, these things are not changing me. How can I be different? How can I change? And so it's not the desirability of change that Nicodemus is questioning, it is the possibility of change. And I think we all need to renew our faith that God is filled with the possibility of change. But even more than that, change is possible, but in Jesus it can actually happen. In Jesus it can actually happen. It can actually happen in him. So there are three things, I think, that stopped Nicodemus from seeing that change was possible. Number one, he was a Pharisee, I've already said that, committed to what? The rules. But the rules were not changing him. And this discourse really brings to light the imperative gospel, or the imperative need in your life and my life for grace. Rules alone don't change us. Being committed doesn't change us. Being a stout believer or a strict believer doesn't change us. There has to be some element of grace that comes in that allows you and I to change. We'll talk more about that. The second thing, he was knowledgeable, but his knowledge was almost getting in the way. Because he's like, Jesus says you must be born again. He's like, oh, okay. I get what you mean. But how do you go into the mother's womb again? Meaning there are three ways in which Jesus meant you must be born again. And he could only see one of them. And here is my point. Sometimes knowledge is not a substitute for understanding. And I think you and I were in danger sometimes of not being able to change because we just are hooked into this modernist ideal that more knowledge is the answer to everything. If you just know more. But sometimes you need to understand on a spiritual level and a human level what's going on more than just have knowledge about it. He had knowledge about a new birth, right? Out of Ezekiel 11 verse 19. He would have read this scripture multiple times. Let's read it together. And I will give them singleness of heart and put a new spirit within them, and I will take away the stony, stubborn heart and give them a tender, responsive heart. He knew that scripture. And yet when Jesus says, you must be born again, he doesn't think, oh, Ezekiel, I need a new heart. He goes, how do I become a baby again? Why? We've already said it. Knowledge without understanding. Knowledge without understanding, coupled with all these three things coupled together, the last one, Nicodemus comes by night. It's a theme of John, is it not? In the beginning was the Word. It's a theme of John, is it not? That he is the light of the world. And in him, Jesus Christ, there is no darkness. He returns to this theme, John does, a little bit later down in this scripture. It's part of the confusion. So three things that are stopping Nicodemus from having this faith in change, and they're the same three things that will stop us from seeing the supernatural change that what God wants in us, but not just in us, but through us. And they were what? Number one, we have the rules, but we have no sense of the grace and the sustenance of God to allow us to change. Number two, we have knowledge, but no understanding. And number three, we're looking for light, but we're searching in the dark. Now, I know you and I don't want to admit it, but separation and loneliness are a tool the devil uses. They put us in the dark. Now, God is not putting us in the dark right now, but circumstances and life has put us where the possibility of darkness is closer than it is at other times. And our ways of getting out of it are less. They're more convoluted. They're more problematic. They're more tiring. But you and I need to realize that as Christians, we cannot find change in the dark. And to admit that there is no possibility of darkness in us is to admit, as John would later write, a lie. And he would say that the truth is no longer in us. To say that we have no sin. So I'm just wondering, we're crying out for change, but are we bound to the same problems? The same viewpoints that Nicodemus has that was stopping him from seeing the ultimate reality of what Jesus is trying to say. Are we stuck in those mindsets? I want to challenge myself. I want to challenge you. Maybe you need to shift some of the mindsets that are going on inside of you in order to see some change come through into your life and into the world. So when Jesus says, you must be born again, it means three things, not just one. Number one, it means from the beginning or completely to have a new heart, to be completely changed from the beginning. This is why grace is required. It's impossible to go back to the beginning without grace. Because without grace, the beginning is to repeat the patterns of the crime, the patterns of the hate, the patterns of the darkness, the patterns of the sin. You can't go back to the beginning unless there is a mechanism to reset the heart that started the story at the beginning, and that's called grace. To put you at the beginning with a fresh understanding and a fresh mindset. Number two, it can mean again, or in the sense for a second time. And I would argue that sometimes we do ourselves a disservice when we fail to recognize that salvation is an ongoing process. We love that feeling of once saved, always saved. And there is an element to which that is 100% true. It's uninterruptible by the devil. It's uninterruptible by many mechanisms. But the one thing we need to remember is that you and I, in the Lord's Prayer, it says, Lord, forgive us our sins. There is a daily renewing of this sense of like, I need to be born again. Yeah. Number three, it can mean from above. So, right, from the start, again, and from above. And this becomes a powerful thing because Nicodemus is looking for the source of the change to come from earth, and Jesus is trying to open the door to a kingdom where the source of the change is otherworldly, heavenly. And when we reduce, when I go back to my beginning thought, if we reduce Christianity to just mere spirituality, we are putting a grounding rod on it. And we are forgetting that the source that we have is supernatural, otherworldly. That the kingdom that Jesus is talking about is not a spiritually rich kingdom on earth. It's a heavenly kingdom that's translated into earth through us. A very subtle difference maybe, but it's not. It's the difference between plugging your life into a AA battery and plugging it into a 120-volt power supply. They both have a bit of power, but the difference between the power ability, the ability of that power source to power your life is just astronomically different. So we must be born again. It's such an incredible phrase, so powerful. In some ways diluted by this sense of like, oh, I'm a born again Christian. And let's put it to one side for a minute and recapture the idea that we're starting afresh from the start. That we're starting for a second or a third. We're starting again. And we're starting in a way that is powered by heaven. This is what Jesus is trying to say. Nicodemus, change is possible, but you got to change your mindset, and you got to begin to realize that it's only possible in me, in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let me just read out a couple of phrases, and then I want to pray for you. The phrase born anew is the idea of rebirth, and it runs through all the New Testament. Peter speaks of being born anew by God's great mercy, 1 Peter 1 verse 3. He talks about being born anew, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, 1 Peter 1:23. James speaks of God giving us birth by the word of truth, James 1 verse 18. The letter of Titus speaks of the water of rebirth, Titus 3 verse 5. Sometimes this is the same idea as spoken about when it comes to the death and the resurrection of Jesus. Romans 6 verses 1 to 11, he speaks of those who have lately come into the Christian faith as infants. 1 Corinthians 3 verse 1 to 2, if anyone is in Christ, they are created what? A new creation. Again, Galatians 6 verse 15, the new self is created after God in righteousness. Ephesians 4, 22, verse 4, the person who is at the first beginnings of the Christian faith is a child. Hebrews 5, 12, 14. This is not a new idea, but it now has become a God idea. You must be born again. Church, let me pray for you. I know that last bit ran together. I was just trying to say it. Some of the scriptures go with the bit before and the bit after, but just ignore that. You can find them. Let me pray for you. Jesus, first of all, we want to recognize you. We want to recognize that each one of us in our own way was seeking the same thing that Nicodemus was seeking, change. And we need to stop for a minute and say, God, if my heart desires change in another, I have to find change in myself. And then we have to admit to ourselves, church, that sometimes we have the most important questions, but we're coming by night. So, Father, we pray that you would take our minds and our hearts and you would do what Jesus is promising. You would take that heavenly source, and by your grace, you would take us out of the night and put us in the light. You would take us out of the dark and put us in a place of sight so we can see, so that we can perceive, and so that we can be empowered by that heavenly source to start again, to be renewed, to take out the stony heart and put in the heart of flesh. God, I pray for all of your beautiful people today that you would strengthen them by your Holy Spirit, that it's not by their might nor by their strength, but by your Spirit. In Jesus' mighty and wonderful name, amen. Hey, love you, church. We look forward to seeing you next Sunday. Have an incredible week. Don't forget, barbecue tonight, 5 o'clock on the river. Look at your emails. We love you. Take care. Bye.